Quake Pits on BCTV is supported by the following.
Good evening, Planet Earth, and welcome back to the Quake Pits. Special welcome to our friends across the pond in the United Kingdom. I am your co-host, Tim Joyce, and I am joined, as usual, by himself, the quaking legend, Tony Russo. How are you, Tony?
Good evening, everyone.
Good to see you, my friend.
Good to see you as well.
I look forward to this more and more every month, seeing you.
It's wonderful. It's a good time.
I know you always tell me you don't know if you should have that moniker of quaking legend, but this weekend at the Danville Heritage Quake Tournament, we're out there talking, and do you remember Sam Mickey? You remember Sam? I don't know if you played with Sam. He's a Moton guy. You might know him if you see him.
Okay.
He's like a younger version of you in body, you know, strong, tan, you know, he's got the same. He was wearing the canvas shorts, the low boat shoes. He didn't have the collared shirt, but I saw him from about 100 yards away, and I did a double take. I thought it was Tony.
Okay.
So I started talking, and someone said, you know, Tony, looks like Tony. I asked someone, and someone else said, I never got to play with him. I wish I got to play with the legend. I never got to play against him. So you are the legend.
I appreciate that. It was, you know, it took a lot of work and a lot of practice, and you know, it just
kind of fell into place.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, it would be a tougher legend call nowadays with the guys that are playing. I mean, they had good players.
People are really good.
But seems like they're getting tougher and tougher all the time.
It is.
I wasn't a ringer player. And we've got a lot of them out there, but I was a blocker. So, and I guess that's maybe why they, you know.
You can still block, and there are blockers. I'm a bit of a blocker.
Right, okay.
Or a blockhead, some people might say. Well, there's a lot of those guys
I wouldn't agree
too.
With that.
but we were up at Danville, which is a place that you won. We talked about it a little bit last month.
Okay, yep.
It was the third leg of the World Quating Tour. You won it in 08?
07.
07, all right. I knew 07. It was in that neighborhood.
Yep. First time Ken Chaos and I pitched together as a team.
Okay.
And we...
The chairman,
we
Kenny
took it
Katz.
All down that day.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, that was great. First tournament you played with him.
Yeah.
Do you remember how many people played that day? How many teams?
Probably in the upper 60s.
Okay. Wow, that's a good turnout.
Between 65 and 72, maybe.
Yeah.
They had some good turnouts.
There were some good turnouts back in the day. Yeah, yeah, there was. The numbers, as the competition level has elevated, it seems the numbers have dropped off. So we had 36 teams this weekend.
Right, right.
A good deal of Danville teams there. Right.
Yeah.
And
I guess the competition might scare them off a little bit, Tim. I don't know.
I don't know. I don't have the answers. People ask me all the time what happened because I've been throwing a long time, and I've seen the numbers change. And as the competition's risen, there's also a lot of tournaments. People have a lot of options to play every weekend.
Right,
Right now we're in a stretch, Tony, where there's a tournament every weekend, five of the six next weekends.
Okay.
It's just nonstop.
We didn't have that back in 07, 08. I mean, we had some weekend tournaments and we had some, you know, during the week tournaments, or not tournaments, but pitching.
Yeah, sure.
You know, local clubs.
Mm-hmm.
But the weekends were mainly the main tournaments.
Yeah. We did Danville this week. We were going to show you some stuff from Danville, and we also have we're going to talk about something that's kind of interesting, is the United Kingdom Quates.
Yes.
And we were trying to have someone call in from over there, but he's not going to make it today, maybe in a future episode.
Okay, excellent.
But let's talk a little bit about Danville. We may or may not have video to show you. We're experiencing technical difficulties.
Okay.
So home viewers are stuck with our ugly mugs
for
the time being. You mentioned Kenny Cass, the founder. There were some great shots.
USQA.
This weekend. And I see a lot, and I try and remember it, but I don't see everything. And there's great shots being made all day, all over the place. But sometimes I get lucky and witness the shot.
Sure,
sometimes I catch it with a camera.
Okay.
Sometimes
wonderful.
I just hear people talking about
it. Yes, yes.
But so we talk about Danville and the Danville boys, and then Kenny Cash, your partner. So in the was it the second round? So the round of 16 teams left in the playoffs.
Right.
Game three, it was Kenny and his partner Dion Bender. And your old pal Kenny.
Okay.
Yep. And game three, tight three-game set. Kenny's got a ringer on, game laying, nothing left in his hand. He's playing Bucky. You may remember Bucky.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You remember Bucky?
Absolutely.
Bucky's grown a little bit wider, and his game's grown. Goes boom, he topped Kenny. And the place erupted. It was everybody but Kenny and Dion enjoyed it. And,
I guess.
Yeah. Even Kenny said, "You got to just give it to him. It's a great shot."
Yeah.
He hit a great shot. So we all felt bad for Kenny and Dion, but nice to see the Danville boys.
Right. Right. Well, that's why they had a lot of support. You know.
Yes.
And they pitch up there all year. It's not like they pitch once in a while.
They do.
They enjoy it. It's a big deal to them up there, and we come up there and their home field and pitch. And,
yeah.
You know, most of the time we're the ones that walk away with the winnings, but you know, so they're happy to keep advancing in the fun, you know.
It's interesting playoffs. You say that. You may remember some of the names of the Danville. You remembered Bucky. Do you remember Ogden? Daniel Ogden?
Yes.
Dan Ogden Sr. Now he hasn't played in a couple years. He did play, I think, 2 years ago. He wasn't there this year, but his son plays.
Okay.
And his son's not a little fella anymore. He's enormous. He's a big guy.
But Dan's a pretty big guy too.
A big man. Yes. But he won that tournament.
Yes.
And he was the local. He may be the only Danville man to have won that tournament.
I remember that.
But I had the pleasure of playing against his son. And you know, how you doing, Daniel? And I said, I couldn't remember his last name, and he reminded me. I said, "Oh, your dad won this, you know, back in the day." And he's like, "Yeah." He's probably tired of hearing it. Yeah, his dad probably reminds him every time they play.
I'm sure. That's cool.
Yeah, so it was good. So we had 36 teams. Mm-hmm. Third leg of the World Quading Tour, and you talk about how the competition, how good it is.
Yes,
and. For once again, not another tournament without a repeat winner. So we've had three majors. We have three different winners
this
year.
Incredible.
Yes.
Neat. So no single team is totally dominating. Everybody's beatable.
Everybody is beatable.
Yes.
Some people are less beatable than others.
Sure.
but everybody can be beat. But there were some incredible shot making. I made a list of some of the things I seen.
Okay.
I just thought I'd share. And since we don't have the video here, you'll just have to picture it in your head as I explain it. Right.
Okay. Before you start on that, I just want to mention one thing. Our phone number here, if anybody wants to call in, Talk Quates, we're happy to receive calls, 610-378-0426. We don't get a lot of calls, but we would love to have people call in and ask questions about quating and anything.
Great call. Great thought by you.
You know, well.
Perfect show to do it, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So if there's anything you want to know, give us a call. We'd love to hear from you.
Okay.
So we had one call once and she hung up, right? I think Kenny's wife or somebody was
somebody's girlfriend
got stage right and hung up.
And I believe Dan Carter's mom called one time.
I think she did. She hung up on us too.
Yeah, so, get a little stage fright or something being on
she TV ain't calling tonight because Danny's not here, but we have some footage of Dan a little bit.
Right. Did they play in Danville?
Oh, they did, yeah.
He and Scott?
They did, Scott and Dan, the Ring Dingers.
Yep.
And they won a tournament earlier this year in the IOOB tournament. It was Sean's, the Quaters versus Cantor. They won that.
Right, okay, okay.
No way, I'm wrong. Dan did win that, but with Lamar Bowers. But he and Scotty also won at IOOB at their regular tournament. And, so I'll break it down for you a little bit. Mm-hmm. 36 teams. So we took 32 to playoffs. So four unfortunate teams didn't make it to the playoffs.
Right.
So that's 16 pits, 32 teams.
Right.
Your top seed were some old timers you're familiar with. I think they were the top seed. I could be wrong. They might have been second. It was Billy Conrad and Steve Shirey.
Oh, okay.
Who is the best? Yep. Just ask him. Yep. Right? but Steve's good. Yes. Steve's healthy and strong, and so is Bill. Bill's walking real well, and they played great.
Very good. Bill got some new parts.
I think they're bionic because he's throwing better.
He's a young guy, but you know, that's all right. That's great.
It is. Yes. Yeah, they played really well.
Yes.
And so they were a top seed. Dwayne and Dan, the Deuce Bags, they were a top seed. So we boil it down. We talked about the big shot against Kenny.
Yes.
That happened in the round of 16. Also in the round of 16, something else I saw, I'll give a shout out to John Switcher. John's been playing up there for a long time. He's a Moton guy. Okay. You may know Nevin Moore as well.
They play
Moton Inc.
Okay.
And they took me and my partner apart in the second round, me and Carl.
Really?
And Nevin just was a bulldog on the front of the pin, and Switcher hit 5-6 ringers, including a topper.
Okay.
So shout out to those guys. Well, we'll get you next time.
Yep.
The Moton Mauler took us apart. But John threw out of his mind. He was great.
Okay.
And so that was in the round of 16.
16.
So we get down to the round of 8, and this is where we would show you some video. And if you can't, we'll put a link out on our website. You can watch these later. There's some footage out there that you can see.
Okay.
But some interesting games in that round of 8, and it was hot. It was really hot.
For some reason, when that Danville tournament's going on, it is murderously hot. It's, you know, well into the 90s, humid, stormy sometimes.
Yes.
You know, I mean, we keep playing unless there's lightning. Then we clear the field, you know, till the storm passes, and then we're back out again. We played there already where the pins rained so hard, the pit is underwater.
Yes.
Okay, and it's covered, but the pin's sticking out maybe an inch or two, so we're still playing the game, and we have to dig and feel. We have to feel underwater that we can't see which quate is closer.
Raise it up.
Right, and see who pitched the quate.
Yeah.
Because we don't know. It's unbelievable.
It reminds me, you mentioned that. That was my first experience throwing in those conditions was down at Hickory Run Campground.
Yes.
I think that was the third world championship. Second or third?
Might have been. I pitched that weekend.
That was awful.
Oh, my God.
That was awful.
I don't know how many sets of quates were lost because they were sinking down 12, 14 inches. That's how bad it was.
Yeah, there was a big splatter. It wasn't it wasn't fun.
No.
Last year's Danville had all that. It had a beautiful morning, then it got super hot, and then it poured rain and got really cold.
Right.
And we showed that footage last year. I don't know if you were here for that one. But that was interesting because everybody's wearing sweatshirts. But this year, hot as could be.
Yep.
In that final 8, we boiled it down to a final four. So you had Lamar Bowers from On Demand. You probably remember Lamar.
Oh, absolutely.
And he was playing with Keith Conrad.
Okay.
So it was Conrad and Bowers versus Conrad and Shirey.
Right, right.
The two Conrad brothers went head-to-head, and Keith and Lamar squeaked that one out.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if it was 2 or 3 games they were throwing for a while. I think it was 3, but I don't remember.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Lamar and Conrad move on.
Mm-hmm.
And the Spring Open champs, Jay and Kay, I forget who they played in that round, but they moved on.
Okay.
So yeah, there's 2 of your final 4. The Ring Dingers, you mentioned Scotty and Dan, they moved on. And the Deuce Bags, who are perennially there at the end of the day. Not unbeatable, but really hard to beat.
Yes.
So it was a great Final Four that was set up. And you had, so we'll start with the first game in there.
Right.
Dwayne and Dan versus Jay and Kay.
Okay.
And Jay and Kay are my boys from Fritz's Island. They wanted that matchup, and they got it. And they played great, but Dan Grigas topped Kyle Kramer 3 times in 1 game.
Oh, my God.
In 1 game. With the hammer each time. So Kyle could do nothing about it.
He
had, you know, Kyle threw great. Dan just had the last shot.
Yeah.
You know, because Jay was getting the pin, you know, from Dwayne.
Right. Almost a disadvantage to have that point.
Yeah. Yeah, and really? Kudos to Kyle because he wasn't scared. He's like, I'm going to throw him and
you better beat me. And, absolutely.
You know, Dan just was through amazing. So all four of those guys, I felt bad. Someone had to lose. But
incredible. Yeah. Incredible. Those are heartbreakers. I mean, it's difficult. But
breaks your heart.
What can you do?
You walk away and, you know, come back and get them the next time.
Yes, yes.
Then down on pit one, we had Lamar and Keith Conrad versus the Ringdingers. And this might have been the match of the day. It was the Ringdingers win game one. They're down hard in game two. They come all the way back, and Scott Hall's got the game laying. They're moving on to the finals.
Right, okay.
And Lamar, with the last quake, hooks it for the walk-off at like 2019, which he did to me down at Old Bastards when we played.
Right, right.
He's been clutch all year pulling these shots out.
Yeah, he's been that way for a long, long time.
You have some stories from playing against Lamar back in the day?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
yes.
He's tough.
He's consistent as can be, and, you know,
And a super nice guy. It's hard to be mad at him, but he'll kill you.
Yeah. True.
So they go to a third game, and the Lamar and Keith are up, and they have the game lay-in at 20-17, I think it was. And with the last quake, Scotty Hall hits a hook tie the game.
Oh, jeez.
And they end up, I mean, it was just unbelievable pressure and great shooting, and they come back and they win that game. So we go to a finals of Ringdingers versus Dwayne and Dan, and so that's a lot of world championships meeting up in the final there.
Sure.
And it was another tremendous throwdown, back and forth, lots of toppers,
I'm sure,
lots of covers, and your boy Danny, who you didn't want to pull back in the day as your partner in the garage, right?
Yep.
They pull it out. They won. Ringdingers win.
He made incredible progress in quakes. He didn't know which hand to throw it with out.
He may be one of the best.
But
he's
incredible.
The best.
Yeah.
You know, there's probably 3, 4, 5 guys you could put in that conversation.
Right,
and
right.
If you chose, you want to say this guy or that guy, it's hard to argue.
Yeah.
They're all really good.
Exactly. Exactly.
But Dan Carter gets a look in his eye, and you know it's going on. You can see it from 40 yards away. I throw at him every Thursday. It's scary. You can see it coming.
Yep.
You know, he's like a volcano. You know it's going to blow up, and you're going to suffer because
Incredible.
Of it. So that was Danville. That was a lot of fun. The next USQA tournament is at Riverfest, and I know Muhlenberg Parks and Recreation have a show coming up on BCTV to talk about Riverfest at some point.
Oh, good.
And so we're having that's going to be the World Championship this year,
right?
September.
So, September.
Yeah,
right,
maybe you can stop out, make an appearance, have a hot dog or something.
Yeah.
There's a lot of food vendors.
Sounds good.
Yeah, we had two-dimensional Tony Russo there last year.
That's
for photo ops.
I'm soon going to be four-dimensional.
I retired him, though. Ever since you told me you didn't want to see that guy no more, I left him in my garage.
I was just kidding you.
I have to get somebody a new face on there.
But, yeah.
Yeah.
Joe Pop.
So that's coming up. We only have a few minutes left. One of the other things we wanted to talk about was quakes in the United Kingdom.
Yes.
Which you and I agreed earlier, we don't know much about it.
No, but you did a little research, and I credit you for that.
A little research,
that's great.
And we have a video, which we'll put links out to.
Right.
We're going to give a shout-out to Joff Furby, who throws with the Lower Dales Quake Club.
Okay.
In the United Kingdom. Their game is officiated by the National Quakes Association, so we're the United States Quaking Association.
Right, right.
Similar game.
Yep.
We throw you want to hold that up for me, Tony?
Absolutely.
We throw that 4-pounder that's that size. This is what they throw, this size, but their quake is 5 1/4 pounds.
5 1/4, and they throw it how far?
33 feet.
33 feet. Ours is 21 feet.
Ours is 21.
It's a 4-pound.
So you can see,
but a much smaller.
Practically the whole quake is the hole.
Yes. That's amazing.
So they have some similarities to the game, and they have some differences. I think what we're going to do is maybe not talk. We won't roll through all our data and stuff here.
Right.
We'll try and get computer back for next month and bring that up again.
Sure.
And maybe we can do an episode on Trenton quates and the little rubber quates and, you know, show some of these other quating pockets
play it on the
that
beach.
Are out there.
People pitch on the beach. Oh, Sean and I used to pitch 30 and 40 games on the beach.
I used to take these down with me, but you throw a four-pound quate in the sand, it disappears.
Yes.
It'll be 18 inches and you're digging, you know, trying to find the quate.
Right.
Better make sure you paint them up real
good. Yeah, but the rubber ones, they only weigh a pound. And, you know, but they're nice. They're solid and they work well.
And that's what people throw up in the Lehigh Valley, Easton. Some people call them Easton quates or slateboard quates.
Right.
The rubber quates.
Right, right.
But like you said, they're 1 pound. They're a lot smaller. So
a
little different. I didn't get to use, glad I got to use my fancy template that I made up for you here today.
Can you imagine that on our on the pits that we pitch on now? You'd have...
It'd be ringers galore.
Full
it'd be like
ringers.
Throwing horseshoes. It'd be nonstop ringers.
Yeah,
be as fun.
And that's exactly what horseshoes
is. These guys step in and heave it. I wish I could show you. I have a great video. But these guys step in and heave it, and they're blocking it. They count upside down quakes, so they go in, out, they block. They throw ringers. Ringers are 2 points.
Right. Is the game 21? Is that what they play till?
They do play to 21.
Okay.
And our 21 is up, Tony. That went quick with no video. We filled all that time.
Yeah.
So we have to sign off. We'll see you next month in the Quake Pits. Thanks, Leisha. Good night.
Night.
Quake Pits on BCTV is supported by the following.